Hey guys, welcome back. Happy Monday. How's everyone doing tonight? Let me know how the audio and the video is coming across. Thumbs up for Please Stand By from Jim. Thanks, Jim. Hope everyone's having a good Monday. Hopefully the stream is going to comply tonight. Didn't have any troubles with setup this week, but as usual, YouTube's doing some changes. I've noticed a few things at the G+, but I don't think it's going to affect our streaming ability. I think we're in good shape tonight, guys. Got a ton of stuff to cover tonight. Been a big week in the tech world, big week in our little community, tons of stuff going on. Had to actually prune the content, and even with it pruned, I don't think we're going to get through it all in the 1 hour. So I think we're going to run over a little bit, but gonna try and ram through it. We'll see what we can do. Peter says the audio and the video is fine. Thanks, Peter. I'm just gonna take a quick look and see who we've got here. With any luck, if I make sure I don't have any phantom windows open too. Got Mike here, Peter's here, Leroy is here, Jim Connor is here, the Scotty is here, Zad Gadkinson is here. We are in good shape, guys. We've got a good little crowd. We're off to a good start. Hope your week's starting out well, guys. Mine was really busy. I just finished the professional job, the daytime job moments before the broadcast. So thankfully, I was able to at least have the content ready yesterday. We had a long, rainy weekend here in southwestern Ontario, so I was able to get a lot done and get some stuff staged for tonight, thankfully. It still wasn't a very fun weekend, though, but that's what we get here sometimes before the happy weather arrives, before too long. All right, guys, I'm going to go ahead and cue things up, hopefully. We'll see if my computer complies with any luck. Leroy says, dang it, a long one tonight, and he has to leave early. Yeah, sorry, Leroy. Thanks, guys, for letting me know the audio and the video is good. Really appreciate it. I'll fire up the chat window here so that future viewers can see what everyone was saying at the time. And maybe, just maybe, we can get the other monitor on the go. Good stuff, guys. As usual, we will cover viewer questions throughout. Just throw them in the chat. Hit me up direct on the Electric Imp. We'll do some tech news tonight. We'll do the viewer challenge. Bunch of stuff on 3D printing. Bunch of stuff from the community of hackers, makers, you name it. Some stuff from the shop. A sneak peek. Tech tip of the week. Live viewer calls we're not going to get to tonight, guys. I'll be honest up front. We're not going to have time for those. Hit me up on the Imp printer. The link is below. If I miss your question in chat, you can send it to me directly to the printer in front of my face. Hopefully it's working well tonight. And yeah, we'll see how it works. And Gary Rudd is here. That's a... Sorry, Gary, I don't think I've seen you here before. If I have, I missed it. Thanks for joining us tonight. Good stuff. All right. Got click happy, guys. First off, before we even get started, a shout out, guys. If you're not already aware, Texas, Oklahoma, southern U.S., really tough times down there. Huge shout out to you guys that are dealing with the extreme flooding and natural disasters going on down there. It's getting ridiculous. And, the only comment would be, if you're in the area and there's anything you can do to reach out to these people, please do. Texas, man, you're getting hit hard. I can't believe it. So big shout out to all my viewers in the southern U.S. Wish you the best. Tech news this week, guys. I just caught Gary's comment. First time. Well, welcome, Gary. Tech news this week. Ton of it, guys. Tons and tons and tons. So we'll start out. The planet Ceres, our dwarf planet. If you haven't already seen this, all these items are linked below. For the new viewers, go to makeme.org. There's an entire show notes. All of these links are viewable in video format. You can check them out at your leisure later. I always make sure I share the videos whenever possible. But Ceres, these odd lights on the dwarf planet, it's an ongoing saga. I'd be interested to know what you guys think. I know what I think of it, And you can actually vote on this now. What is it? Is it ice? Is it minerals? Is it an optical illusion? Is it other blah, 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 blah? So check this article out from CNET. They link to the voting method where you can cast your vote. What is it? I guess we'll find out as we get closer. So this week, Google. It's all about Google this week. Tons and tons of news on Google. And this one in particular, it was just the Google Cardboard got upgraded for more phones and new design and various other things. Really cool. I'm a big fan of Google Cardboard, and I'll be honest. I couldn't get mine to work with the, I think it was a Galaxy S3 that I was using, and now I have access to an S4. I'm going to give it another try, and if I can get it working, I'll do a video on it. Because I'm really, really excited with this virtual reality, where it goes. And Google Cardboard, if you're not familiar with it, it's just a dirt cheap method for people to give it a try with Android phones. And what little success I had, I wasn't able to change the views with the little magnetic slider on my phone, because it just wasn't sensitive enough. But what little success I had, this was totally cool out of a piece of cardboard. So pretty cool that Google Cardboard is getting a new little facelift and more phones and more adaptability. So we'll see how that goes. And yeah, the electric imp. Sorry, guys. My imp printer happened last week, too. I only got half of the comment that was just posted. Really, really weird. I'm not sure what's going on. Must have a problem with that, so I can't read what the text was, whoever sent a message recently, so sorry about that. Hopefully it clears up. It did last week, so I better check the code on that. More Google news this week, guys. Google Photos. Unlimited storage for life of your photos. Google Photo has committed to this, so Picasa, I guess, has gone the way of the dodo, and I forget, I guess this is integrated with Google Drive somehow. It is a standalone app. Unlimited for everyone, for life, for photos. This is a bold move. So we'll see where this goes. You can check out this video on This Week in Tech. Netcast Network did a pretty cool video coverage of it. I think you guys will find it interesting. So I just got one comment before it left the chat. Alien porch lights for the series lights. Glitch says it's aliens. I just could catch up on the chat real quick, guys. I have to do this once in a while. I try and keep up with the chat as much as possible. This is a live show. This is a community show. So I try and keep up with you guys. And we'll see how this goes. I won't be able to keep up much longer. There's a lot of comments. Zach says, is this thing on? Good stuff. All right, guys, carry on. More. This video, I won't even try and summarize, because it's basically a summary of some of the Google stuff. Long story short, Google new products from I/O take aim at Apple. Well, we knew this was coming. Android has been a strong contender. The Google products, hugely strong contender, and has the backing of Google. I wish them all the best as they move forward in their new marketing campaigns and their new ventures. And check out this video if you just want to see a summary of some of the products that were shown off. I won't even try to go over it. Guys, I want to know what you think of this. So this week, judge makes example of Silk Road founder with life sentence. So if you guys aren't familiar, Silk Road was kind of the dark space eBay. It was the dark corners of the net. Some nefarious stuff went on for selling of drugs and whatnot, but the founder, the hands-off founder of this life sentence, this is a real life sentence, guys. Let me know what you think. Is it right? Is it just? Should someone be held accountable what gets sold on their website if you're running an auction website, even though you weren't anywhere near it? I'd be interested to know what you guys think. It's pretty harsh stuff. A life sentence. This is serious. This is someone's life. So as we move forward into these unknown areas, now the laws are being written, essentially. The laws already existed, but these are gray areas, guys. So let me know what you think of the... That was weird. Let me know if I'm back, guys. Just got dumped. This only happened once before in one other live broadcast. We lost connection, but oddly, it was only the YouTube server connection. I have multiple other sources here I'm watching, and they didn't get dumped. Weird. Maybe the YouTube servers are going to have some problems tonight. Hopefully not. And... Glitch said, Eric, I'm not even going to get started. There's so much injustice going on here that I could go on for weeks. Yeah, I'd love to hear what you guys think on it. It's good to voice our opinions because essentially we are... Maybe we can't directly influence the laws and the outcomes, but it's good to talk about it. So, yeah. All right, you guys say I'm back. Good stuff. It's funny. I didn't drop a single frame. It was only the YouTube server connection completely closed. Sorry about that, guys. Hopefully, we're good. Yeah, it jumped, time traveler. It's better now. Your lip sync was wrong before. Weird. Weird, weird. There must be something going on with the YouTube servers tonight, guys, because I have another PC just off camera, and I do run some monitoring of multiple links, and it's fine. Totally fine. So, yeah, well, meh. Let's see. Glitch said, I just want to make this clear. This guy is in prison for life, running a business, and there are people who serve 10-year sentences or even walk free for rape and murder. Why? Yeah, that's a good question. David said, morally, I have a huge problem with Silk Road, but legally, I don't know the details. Good thought, David. Yeah, I don't know. I don't know. I'm curious to see what you guys think. I'm not really going to weigh in overly on that one because I hope the justice system has done the right thing and will prevail. Obviously, there's going to be appeals on that one, so let's see where it goes, guys. All right, let's go. Community announcements. Got some stuff this week, guys. The MakeMe.org, the MakeMe community, our little G+ community, over 400 members. We crossed 400 the week before last, and I didn't get a chance to announce it. Thanks, guys. Awesome stuff going on there. Love seeing your projects in the MakeMe community. It's a lot of fun. Tons of good stuff in there. We're going to cover some of it. On the YouTube side, we crossed 8,000 subscribers this week. This morning, I think we were at 8,049 here in the screenshot. So pretty cool. We're doing pretty good, guys. We've got a pretty good following here. It's a lot of fun. So cheers to all you guys that are subscribers. If you're not already, click that subscribe button. This one I promised for a little while, and I'm finally getting this done. So this week I did a live broadcast on Periscope, which is the Twitter-based live broadcasting platform. And what I was able to do, because it was kind of a vlog format, I'm able to save the local copy to the device that I'm transmitting on, my phone, and I uploaded it to the Make Me Media channel. I didn't think it really belonged on the main channel, so I put it on the Make Me Media channel, which you guys, if you're not already subscribed, you can go to the description below and you can subscribe there. And the plan is I'm going to continue to do live broadcasts, not just this one, but whenever I can, little short ones via Periscope or Meerkat. And if you don't, if you follow me on Twitter, you'll see them when they're live, but not all of us can catch each other's live broadcasts just at a moment's notice. So if you can't catch the replay on the app, you can catch it on the Make Me Media channel anytime later. So, the first live Periscope show, well, it's not the first, but it's the first vlog format is there for you guys if you want to check it out. Hope you guys like it. And I'm just going to catch up on the chat real quick. BMS Web is here. Hey, Paul, good to see you. I'm glad you made it. And Jim said 8,000 subscribers. Impressive. Nice work. Thank you, Jim. Glitch is still doing some discussion. Glitch said, congrats. Thanks, guys. Really appreciate it. Steven said, also, Eric, with Periscope, it's now available on Android. Yes, Steven, I think Glitch tried it that first night, and there was some glitches with it, as expected. I had no luck with the Meerkat app the first time I tried it on Android either, but guys, I'll be honest. I really think these instant live broadcasting platforms are going to take hold and are going to be an interesting and valuable tool. I'm gravitating towards Periscope. I'll be honest there. I think it's way more functional. It allows the replay that you guys can watch later on, 24 hours. As also, you can watch it on the web. So I'm really gravitating towards Periscope, and I'm actually having a blast following other people on it and catching their live shows. Even if you can just drop in for a few seconds, you tap the screen, you can give them a heart, which is like the thumbs up. You can give them a thousand of them. It's a really neat platform for news or just whenever you get the chance, go live right now and have some community involvement. I'm kind of excited about it. So yeah, there'll be more to come, guys. Jennifer Horner is here. Hey, Jennifer. And Jennifer asks, do you know how to fix a computer that has viruses? I'm sure you get lots of help in the chat, Jennifer. And BMS Web, he just got the head play review video shortly, buddy. Good stuff. And good stuff. I think we're caught up, guys. All right, let's go carry on. So this one I'll go large screen on. So I ranted about this last week, guys. Hackaday prize, 2015 Hackaday prize. If you have anything you're building, any project at all, projects you've built before and haven't published, or even if you have published them on Hackaday, guys, you need to go over there and submit them to the 2015 Hackaday prize. As of today, there was 477 projects submitted for the 2015 prize, and I won't go over the prizes here. First prize is a trip to space, a real one. This is big stuff, guys, but the cool part of it is, besides the exposure for your project and sharing it with an awesome community, they are giving away prizes every week, and I mean a pile of them. So in the past, I announced that we won the Osh Park, my gas sensor grenade project. I won the Osh Park $50 in PCBs, what we're going to use here on the channel. After that, I won a Bluetooth-enabled microcontroller, which I didn't even get a chance to redeem. Last night, I happened to visit the site and realized 17 days ago, I had won again, and I won a Teensy LC, which is a Teensy, low cost. Another little micro, it's a $12 micro, and I hadn't done anything. This is not judging, this is, I'm not sure their criteria for giving these away, but they have a ton of prizes. And I'm sure they try and gear them towards making your project better or giving you maybe something you can use in your project. If you haven't submitted one, guys, you gotta go to Hackaday.io and submit whatever you're building on, even if it's just a concept. Because if you win, you can get, say, the Teensy LC as a microcontroller. Maybe you can use that in your project and build it up. I've talked to Mike over there. He's an awesome guy. They're a great bunch of people. You can't fail, guys. Long story short, get over there, submit your projects. You just gotta do it. Take my word for it. So we're on our third prize now. That's pretty awesome. And Glitch said, I need to get my camera project. I'm started posting up and an overview of my e-bike. Yes, you do, Glitch. You've gotta get those over there. And guys, we are going to touch on both of those projects, I guess. And Jim said, I've been thinking about using a Teensy for making an Elite Dangerous panel. Yeah, I'll be honest, I am not familiar with the Teensy at all, so I have to go look things up. I hadn't even sent in the order for the first Bluetooth enabled microcontroller I won yet until last night. So I ordered both of them free of cost, free shipping, They just give you a discount code and it comes through. So when I get those guys, you're going to see some videos and some coverage on them. It's going to be fun. Kudos to Hackaday. They're just killing it. They're really, really awesome people and trying to make it easier for makers and inventors out there by running an awesome contest. They're all members of the community, so that's pretty cool stuff. Jim said Teensy looks great for making custom USB devices. Yeah, that was the one thing I did notice immediately. Native USB support. That could be fun. I think it has profiles available for all sorts of HID devices, Jim says. Yeah, I'm guessing that's what I'm gonna have to use it for. First thing, gotta give it a try. Anyway, we'll see. And Leroy's having trouble with his video. Sorry, Leroy. I have zero dropped frames, so I'm not sure what's going on with the early hiccup either. I don't know. We'll see how it goes. Let's go, guys. I'm gonna go way over tonight. I could yak about a lot of this stuff all night long, guys. 3D printing. As a lot of you know, I have some of the parts of an InMove robot printed, and one of the channels I subscribe to is Marcus Orngren. I don't think I've shared any of his videos here before, but he's got a really well completed InMove 3D printed humanoid robot, and now he's moving to doing pressure sensors on the forearms of it. DIY pressure sensors. Really, really cool to see this evolve. They took Gael's original design, as we all did, and now expanding upon it. Now things are starting to get a little exciting. So check out Marcus's video. I think you'll like it. Along those lines, so I've seen tons of 3D printed prosthetics in the last year and a half. It's been all the rage, popular topic, but I've seen very few of them that were actually published where you could download the code and the G code or STLs or whatever to print them yourself. So the Handy, as well, this is linked in the show notes, guys. This one is kind of interesting. This one is more, the InMove has been adapted to be a prosthetic numerous times, and Gael even has a standalone prosthetic. But this one seems more industrial, seems more purposely designed, still servo driven. Really, really cool little design, and from what I can tell, I found their GitHub site and I couldn't make sense of the files, but it does seem legit. It does seem like they published this open source, and there's tons of patent and GPL licensing and stuff on their site, and it looks like it's legit. So guys, check this out. I'm always hesitant to support unless it's really out there for the people to use and make better, and I think this one is. Let me know back what you find out about this Handy. EXE or EXII is the channel name. Not a lot of subscribers, so I think this is pretty fresh on the scene. All right, let's see. What have we got in the chat, guys? Not a lot. Maybe my chat's not working the best. Leroy said he was weird, but he was all caught up now with his video. Okay, good. All right, guys. I still got no drop frames, so I think we're serving, perhaps. I don't know whether the printer is working, but I guess we'll find out, guys. Okay. BMS Web, all kinds of great advice going on. It's awesome to have Paul here. Guys, reminder, if you're new here or if you've been here before and I haven't preached it enough, all these names going on in the chat on the right hand side of your screen, hover over their names. Most of them have YouTube channels. You should probably, if you're a maker, an inventor, or a tech enthusiast, you should really subscribe to most all of the people in here that have YouTube channels. Some awesome stuff at all of them. It's really great community, guys. Just hover over their name and you can check out their channel. Community support, guys. Reminder, if you want to support this channel, please remember, if you're not already subscribed, click subscribe. Click that thumbs up button down below on this video. It really, really helps the channel, guys. It goes for all the other videos too. Remember, share this out. If take 2 seconds, throw this out on social media if you don't mind, guys. It really, really helps out. Get some people in here, spread the word, get the community going, get us all excited some more. It's awesome. It really helps, guys. If you find yourself in a position, you can check out my Patreon campaign down below where you can directly pledge to support the channel. All Patreon-trans get early access to my videos, and as we move forward, there'll be more perks and things to be developed. Alright, guys. I think my chat client all of a sudden decided to work. And it just... it's alright. We just had a lull. Gary Rudd says, I need me a channel. No problem, Gary. If you're making anything, throw it up on YouTube. It allows us all to learn from all the other people out there. It's YouTube's a great platform for this. I firmly believe that. Steven said, I think I'm following most of the people in here, and most of them are also following me. I can echo that. Pretty sure almost everyone that's been here before, I probably am subscribed. If I am not already, please let me know, because sometimes I do miss them. My feeds are pretty busy. And yeah, Glitch heard his own bing. Yeah, I don't have the headphones or the audio killed yet, so I think we're all right though, Glitch. I'll catch up with your message after. Let's go. What else we got, guys? Viewer challenge for this week. So each week, guys, I want to see what you're making. You can hit me up on any of the socials. Hit me up on the G Plus community is a great place to throw anything, that projects that you're sharing or whatever. But if you make a YouTube video, please remember, post it also in the G Plus community. You can show it off here. Sometimes I don't get to see all of the YouTube's really needs to do some work. The subscription service sometimes does miss video. So if you're posting something and you're here viewing each week, or you're part of our community in any way, don't be shy. Dump it in the G Plus community or hit me up directly on any of the socials. Please do. I'm on Instagram, Vine, Meerkat, Periscope, Twitter, obviously any of them, and I'll make sure it hits the show. So Glitch this week, DIY Mega Zoom security camera with Arduino proof of concept. I love seeing this stuff, guys. Repurposing components for what they were never ever designed to do. Glitch took a very simple servo, hooked it to an Arduino, stuck it on top of a camcorder, and he gets remote operation of the zoom function. That's it. It's that simple. He took and added a functionality very simply with off-the-shelf components that never existed before for that camera. Works pretty cool. Good job, Glitch. Thanks for sharing that. Leroy Miller shared with us. He gets all the cool... I gotta go to garage sales. So he got this is a hobby-grade RC truck, I guess. Somewhere between a truck and a van. It looked like something like the Tamiya lunchbox to me, except industrial grade. And I forget what, Leroy, how much did you pay for this? Was it 10 bucks? Like that. Was able to fix it, and he's got himself a new robot platform. That simple. Totally cool. Love seeing these garage sale finds. And I really do, this one resonated with me because I've been looking for a robot chassis. As most of you know that have viewed my channel, I have the Sane Smart four-wheel drive robot chassis, and the thing is fine in the basement for proof of concept on hardwood, but there's no way I can take it outside. What you got, Leroy, is exactly what I'm looking for. So yeah, if anybody has a spare four-wheel drive RC chassis they want to send, please do. Awesome stuff, Leroy. Thanks for sharing that. Leroy also shared some stuff from the Leonardo Pro Micro. I think he's got some coming. Check this out in the G Plus community. Link down below, guys. You can view the whole post. Leroy also shared two ultrasonic sensors adding some distance measuring to his vehicle. Pretty cool stuff. A lot of us have alerts on our newer vehicles now. When you're about to run into something, we can easily duplicate this with Arduino and retrofit it to any vehicle. Pretty cool stuff. Love to see it. Glitch also shared his homemade electric bike. And his pack that he's running on this is with recycled 18650 cells. And this was really cool. I loved this glitch. I was eager to see this video, and I will say I want one. I want one bad. This is a cool bike. I would love to have a normal looking, very self-contained, normal bicycle that runs on, it doesn't matter what cells it runs on. I'd be happy with anything. I'd just love to have one. I think this is totally cool. I love seeing it. Love it that it's a DIY build too, guys. Elisio Cardoso, greetings from Portugal. Hello to Portugal. It's getting late there too. Gary said, my one and only big project got picked up by Make. First original Arduino project. Gary, can you share that in the G+ forum so I can catch up with it later? FYI, these comments don't stay in the chat after. I can't go back and get that. And Zach said, nice score to Leroy. I'm still jealous of that. I've been looking for a four-wheel drive robot chassis. I used to see them at Walmart all the time. I'd be happy with just a toy plastic one, but they don't have such things anymore. They've gone away from, remember those big four-wheel drive RC trucks, like 30, 40 bucks cheap. They were cheap junk, no question, but I could make that work for what I have in mind. Yeah, Leroy said 10 bucks. Jealous. Good stuff. Glitch is talking about batteries. They came out of laptop batteries. Yeah, it's awesome stuff, guys. I think Glitch has a previous video on his channel about the 18650s too, so you guys should check it out. All right, guys, let's carry on. We're going to go way over tonight. Sorry about that, guys. So from the community, guys, tons of stuff from the maker community, hackers, inventors, DIYers, amateur radio, everything goes here, guys. So I'm a little leery about this one, so I might have to delete the link. This showed up in my news feed. Element14.com shared a video. Join the Vertical Farming Design Challenge. Free dev kits and equipment. And right away, this piqued my interest because I'm also interested in growing things and greenhouses and the future of how we grow our food. So the link didn't work in the description. And now I just noticed before we went live that this video is now unlisted. And my comment on the video is the only one showing. I didn't get a message saying don't share this. So and they didn't delete my comment. So guys, maybe watch element14.com for this upcoming challenge, this vertical farming challenge. I think this is something right up our alley. I know someone who it is right up their alley, Jim Connor, who was with us. If Jim is still here, guys, you gotta check out Jim's channel. He put out a video this week on his hydroponic greenhouse update and his first golden berries, which is actually a berry I'm familiar with. We used to call him some kind of lantern here though, but Jim has an amazing greenhouse setup. Jim also makes videos on Arduino and other microcontroller stuff and electronics. You gotta check out his channel. You'll like this video. And Jim, maybe check out the Element 14 and see if you can connect with them with this contest. I think what you do is right along the lines of what little I saw on their contest. So yeah, I thought that was a neat little alignment. Good timing too, because I watched both videos within 10 minutes of each other. Ringway Manchester, I don't know whether he's with us tonight. I did a video on his favorite Baofeng accessories, and I don't think I have my Baofeng or, oh, I do. There it is. That's on these cheap Chinese made radios, two-way radios, and he has a pile of them and a bunch of really cool accessories and went over his favorites in a video, and it's really, really awesome. I can't say enough about these things. This is the Baofeng UV5R. This radio has just been by my side constantly, and during when the tornado went through here, was very, very handy. So check out Ringway Manchester's video on his Baofeng accessories. Just gonna catch up on the chat real quick. Zach said that Element 14 video was set to listed today when I was on their channel. Okay, good, Zach. Thank you. I was a little leery about sharing it when I noticed that. Maybe they fixed the link to their website too. Thank you. I appreciate that. So I now I don't have to worry about sharing it. Maybe they should work on whether they want it private, listed, or public when they publish it. Jim is here. He will check it out. Thanks, Jim. Good stuff. And Glitch said, holy crud, that's a lot of Baofeng. Yeah, sure is. Or Baofeng, whatever your preference, guys. I don't know the correct pronunciation of that, but I like Baofeng. Post a lot. Sorry, I'm stumbling here now. Post-apocalyptic inventor, one of my other many favorite YouTube channels, did a really cool video on how welding transformers work. Tear down an explanation. So he tore down a few different transformer setups. Really informative stuff. He showed how these very large scale transformers actually work in a very understandable manner. There's not much to these welders, guys, and I tore apart a few of them because I've had to repair them. But he did a really good job, and I think you guys like this. Anybody into making and fabrication, I think this is right up your alley. Before I go to this next one, I think I better take a drink. I've got a rant coming on, guys. Jim said it was past my bedtime, but I'm hanging on. Sorry, guys, overseas. I know it's late for you guys. Steven said, if there's a zombie apocalypse, I'm heading to his house. Me too. I'd have to cross an ocean, but yeah. And Glitch loves his channel too, guys. I actually support the post-apocalyptic inventor on Patreon. Guys, don't forget, a lot of other people have Patreon campaigns. If you really value your videos, their videos, you can check them out. All right, guys. So this week, EEV Lab number 10. Why learn basic electronics? From Dave Jones, he needs no introduction here. I imagine everyone here is subscribed to Dave Jones. If you're not, you probably should be. So the video was a viewer question, and I took notes. The viewer question, it was via Reddit, said, is it useful to learn electronics or just save time and do the plug and play thing? Dave did a really awesome video response to this, and I agree with some of his points, but I have to say I disagree, Dave, with a good portion of the underlying response, if that makes any sense. I think Dave really missed the mark here in responding to this viewer. So the question is, a lot of people are interested, should they learn electronics theory and basic electronics? And honestly, guys, electronics, learning it from the ground up theory level, can be like watching paint dry, or worse, like getting teeth pulled. Some of it is really dry stuff, and a lot of it you might not ever use again in your life. And I'm a huge fan of learning by doing. So Dave went off talking about some of these pre-made components we can get now. Here's the Raspberry Pi, popular microcontroller, PCduino, chip on board, hugely functional. The Arduino microcontrollers, hugely functional. And the fact that we can now download code and schematics and pre-made circuits. And this viewer was interested, should they learn the basic electronics? And Dave said yes. And his exact quote was, if you start with pre-made circuits and code, learning electronics... Oh, actually, no, that was my response. It is application electronics, he said, you won't get you very far. And I disagree. I think if you start with this stuff, learning basic electronics will become collateral damage. There's a lot of people out there who don't have the time and energy to go into component level function. And if we start with basic circuits that you can download from the communities and basic code, inevitably, in my opinion, this is where I deviate from Dave, you will always want to add something else. And in a lot of cases, it's not going to work and you're going to need to figure it out. Or add something like, say, voltage monitoring to an Arduino. You want to monitor the voltage on a pin and you need to set up a voltage divider. Well, for that, you need to understand the basics of how a resistor works and basic Ohm's law. Even if you download the how-to from a forum, as collateral damage, you learn the basic electronics that goes with it. And I think these things are really a gateway drug into getting people into the hobby and shouldn't be frowned upon as turnkey solutions. Yeah, you can start with a turnkey solution. This one that I'm holding in my hand is the organic LED. Tons and tons of code out there, my own included. I did a dedicated video on how to get people started and the code. But the minute they want to add something else, that's where the learning process occurs, in my opinion, and allows people to branch off. Yeah, they may not understand the fundamentals, the very basic fundamentals, but when things don't work, a lot of the time you're not going to do damage. And if you do, well, the resilient people will try and figure out where they went wrong. I think Dave really missed the boat on this video, and I really think that people should give these more credit than what they do, that the microcontrollers are indeed a gateway into the electronics community and not necessarily something you need to shy away from without knowing basic fundamentals first. I think people should dive right in and get them and play with them. And if you blow one up or blow a component up, you should figure out where you went wrong as best you can and try again. That's my rant, guys. Hopefully it's not way off. We shall see. Jim said, no point in learning stuff you'll never use. I couldn't agree more, Jim. Most of what I learned in electronics, I'm a bad example because I do have some electronics fundamentals, but I'm not a trained electronics engineer. I learned them in trade work, actually, and then in multiple career paths. But I'm not an engineer. I learn a lot of this by doing, and a lot of the stuff I did learn in a formal environment is useless to me, long forgotten. Honestly, how much time, there's got to be an electrical engineer in here, how much time did you spend memorizing resistor color codes, if you can remember that far back? Never used it again. If I need to know the resistor color codes, I still don't have them memorized. I Google it, or I hook up a meter to the thing. Anyway, that's my rant. And not coming down on Dave's video at all. Let me caveat, I just disagree with this particular one. His videos are awesome. And I just disagree with this one because I don't want to put anyone off in getting into this hobby. Sasquatch said, if you listen to the Amp Hour show, he clearly says it should be top-down learning. Yeah. Our calculus skills. Oh, good stuff, guys. I figured that's my rant. All right, guys, let's go. Too long of a rant. Let's carry on. FPV drone racing in rural Canada. This one blew me away, guys. This is by Motherboard, big channel. This was 10 minutes from my house in a town called Clinton, Ontario, which has now stepped up and done an FPV RC racing course. And they did a big event. I had no idea Motherboard attended this. People drove from all over. Really cool video coverage of it. And I hope this takes off in my area, especially 10 minutes down the road. This is a small town, like 2,000 people-ish. Really, really small rural town. It was really cool to see they repurposed the horse stadium for the day, which is an awesome venue for RC quadcopter racing. So you guys might like this, and hopefully this sport is taking off. I hope it is in your area. I can't wait to try someday. Colin Furzy, I never know how to pronounce Colin's channel. Guys, a million subscribers. Huge thing. He does a lot of making crazy, inventing crazy stuff videos. He set off 300 rockets all at once in honor of his million subs. This is not tech related, but it was a pretty cool video. Check it out, guys. I think you guys will get a smile out of it. Jim, I just catch up on the chat real quick. Jim, I'm still curious. I can't go back and see these until the replay, guys. So Jim Connor said, I've long since forgotten everything I learned at university, so I just Google it when I need it now. Yeah, another person. Can't agree more. David said he commented on that video last week, pretty much agreeing with what you said. Math is a very hard subject for me. Mine too, David. All my experience and knowledge is gained through experimentation and pre-made modules. Yeah, my learning curve was exponentially increased once I started playing with the micros. I had no idea how easy it was, and then relearned a lot of the core level knowledge that I had long forgotten. It was a great gateway for me. Sasquatch said, "Am I the only person who gets fed up with quadcopters these days?" Yeah, no, I don't know. You tell me. I get fed up with the term drone sometimes, even though I use it once in a while, but I really like where quadcopters are going and the functionality that they're going to serve. Glitch said 300 rockets, utterly ridiculous. Sasquatch said first, so call it first. Good stuff. Yeah, Zach said, I subscribe to all the same channels as him. Yeah, it's pretty common in this community, Zach. We're gonna, whenever I can, that's why I share these videos. I try and select channels that, whenever possible, that I think maybe are not well shared or subscribed to by you guys out there. Because, a lot of them, I know you guys are probably already watching, but some of them, the mainline ones that I think really fit this show, I have to share them each week. So yeah, we subscribe to a lot of the same channels. Pretty soon we're not going to need TV anymore, guys. I already don't. Orange Penumbra said rockets confirmed for not tech related. Yeah, well, it's still part of the fun. All right, guys, let's go. Computing Forever, this is a channel I have showed here a few times. The future of medical technology. This is cool stuff, guys. He does a really awesome chat on some medical tech and where it's headed. It's more a lot of his thoughts and current events and current tech. It's a really cool tech channel. Check it out, guys. I think you'll enjoy it. This is a topic that's near and dear to me right now. You're going to see some medical stuff coming up on this channel. Sneak peek. David Watts, who is still with us, did a video, an update video on his upcoming projects. I won't even go over everything that he had in here. He had his, what do you call that thing, David? The sound cube thing. And then some proximity measuring that I had never seen before on his channel. I don't know whether I missed these videos, but really enjoyed David's update video. And cheers, David. Can't wait to see your next projects. So this one, I don't think I've shared this channel before, or maybe have. Afrotech Mods, what is a Schottky diode? This one I thought you guys might find interesting because going along with earlier, as we work with these micros, I'll give my example. I needed to be able to use multiple microcontrollers out to a single device, and that was the 433 megahertz transmitter. But I needed to not cause the devices to backfeed into each other, and for that, I needed a diode in between them. But a normal diode was too slow for the pulse width modulated high-speed signal that I'm sending, and what did I use? A Schottky diode. And I ordered an assortment of them. This video I found to be one of the best explanations of what a Schottky diode is, why you may need it, and what the drawbacks or differences are between it and a standard diode, which basically leads you to when you might want to use it. And in my case, I wish I would have seen this long ago because it took me a while to figure out what I needed. But yeah, check it out, guys. I think you might like that. I'm gonna catch up on the chat really quick. And Jim said he gave up on TV last year. Zach canceled his TV. I can't agree more, guys. It's getting to the point now where finally, with these live shows and the content we have, we can finally be in control of what we want to see, commercial free for the most part. Copper 101 great said, "Who need TV? Nothing good on TV. YouTube is way better." Couldn't agree more. David, yeah. David said it was called the Audio Cube, guys, and it's a real pain in his beep. So, yeah, good stuff. Love it. And some advice coming in for David on his cube, so check it out, guys. All right, some good chat. Awesome stuff, guys. So, this video is not a new one. This is an old video. I was going through my favorites, and I actually noticed that the video was deleted, so I had to go looking for it again because I knew where it was in my favorites and I wanted to check this out. Jet Engine Backyard Episode 1. This is a very, very old coverage, and basically in this shot you can see as a Rolls-Royce Derwent turbine engine. For those of you who have watched me a long time, you've probably heard me mention it before. In my previous career in the automotive trade, I started off with pulse jets, messing around with them in my spare time prior to me having a video camera to record it. And I actually made a gas turbine engine and then made another one, which I actually still have most of the components for. Well, this guy did the same thing, except he went and got this massive Rolls-Royce turbine engine. And in this video, you see the sheer power of this thing playing in his backyard. It's just awesome. If you're into, well, a lot of people here are into aviation too, check this out. I think you might get a laugh out of it and maybe build yourself a DIY gas turbine engine. I'll caveat that. If only I had the power of this Arduino board when I was building the gas turbine engine, my life would have been so much easier. Just measuring RPM of the engine up to 110, 120,000 RPM was virtually impossible. I had to use infrared LED and infrared transistor, but then manually count the values with a frequency counter. And then actually that I had to view that and know what each value meant by doing the math for the RPM. Now I could just do an LCD with full control. I'm tempted to pick up that project again because with a $3 microcontroller, I can instrument a gas turbine. It's amazing how far we've come since I started playing in the maker world. But yeah, we'll see where it goes. Gutch said I should look up Hannibal, Missouri Jet Boat. I'll have to check that out. Sasquatch said if you like jet engines, Agent JZ has a very good channel. Sasquatch, if you can share that in the G Plus community or hit me up on any of the socials with that, I'd appreciate it. Yes, I do love jet engines. I love aircraft. As a lot of people who subscribe to me know, I have a majority of a full functional Lear cockpit in the basement. I like aviation. I especially like turbine engines. Yeah, I should pick up the build again on that. But yeah, I'd be interested in checking out any channels. And Tomori Cat said, not a great fan of TV. Top Gear has a show, but its replacement program is supposed to be a multi-cop build challenge. Interesting. Cool. Good stuff, guys. I think I'm pretty much caught up. Let's go. Harry Fun number 110. He did ESP 8266 Matrix, and I think this was just published last night or so. I just caught it in time for making the pre-made content for this show. Basically, if you're not familiar with it, guys, the 8266 Wi-Fi module is a crazy powerful little sub $3 microcontroller with Wi-Fi on board, and Harry's using it to do some scroll text across an I2C LED setup. Really, really cool stuff. Love seeing where this is going with these ultra cheap components. You can check out Harry's Hackaday contest or Hackaday prize entry as well, probably linked from his channel. So check it out, guys. Julian did a post bag this week, and I thought this was, I don't share Julian's videos enough. I really should, but I'm pretty sure a lot of the people here are subscribed to Julian. If you're not, you should be. Julian Postbag was the AD9833 waveform generator, and I thought this, I've rarely seen such a powerful little waveform generator on a tiny little cheap board, and I'm tempted to give this a try just to play with it because there are times where it can be really, really handy to have just a very simple waveform generator, not just the test function on your scope. And I think this, I was impressed. So I'm going to check this out, guys. I got to do a little more research and have a look at the specs on this thing. But it looked very interesting. It caught my eye really quickly. So, yeah. We'll see. Quick look at the chat. Lots of good chat going on. David's got to go. Sorry, David. Sorry to keep you up again, David Watts. Glad you could make it, buddy. Awesome to see you guys. Check out David's channel. M.I. Sperry. Kimon. There we go. M.I. Sperry. This is a channel that I just recently came across, and I don't remember how we managed to hook up, but I shared some messages with him. A really interesting channel. He does some long format videos, and this one he made an RS-232 to TTL converter. Hardware right off perf board and did the complete build start to finish. And once in a while, I just enjoy sitting down and watching a long format video when I have the time of somebody making something and the creative process and the problems they run into. Admittedly, guys, I heavily edit my YouTube videos now to try and get them down to a viewable format that not a lot of people have long time. And it's kind of bad because I do enjoy watching a long format. Anyway, long story short, check out M.I. Sperry's channel. He does some awesome builds. Really cool guy, always happy, and I think you guys definitely gravitate towards his videos. Pretty cool stuff. Rotor DR1. So I mentioned this before. We had some talk about the quadcopters and stuff before here, guys. A few weeks ago, I mentioned Rotor DR1, which is Chad Capper, Stone Cap Productions, which is also AKA the Flight Test Boys, Flight Test on YouTube. The Rotor DR1 project was a 10-part series, and they're all 10 minutes-ish or longer segments of crowd, not crowd-funded, but they used people's input in the forums and throughout multiple, like Facebook and everything, to develop the storyline of this independent film. Guys, it's incredible. I can't believe I didn't get around to finally seeing it start to finish until just this week. I watched all 10 episodes and I was blown away. The production quality of this drone quadcopter apocalyptic storyline is just incredible. They did an awesome job, and you can tell they enjoyed it. It even has David Vindisil in it, and all kinds of cool people. BMS Webb, that might still be here, his son even has a quick blurb in the beginning of it, and I managed to catch that the first video of this part one. You're gonna see that right away. It was pretty cool stuff. Guys, you gotta check this out. You gotta watch this. If you're in C or quadcopters or supporting independent films, entire 10-part series on YouTube. You gotta see it. Can't say enough about it, guys. I was blown away. It was far and beyond what I ever expected of them. And I knew Stone Cap Productions does an awesome job. And I just can't believe it. Even the acting and the settings and the cinematography is amazing. Not entirely tech related, but it is, guys. These are some awesome guys from the community of makers of RC stuff, so gotta check it out. Glitch said, Eric, ever considered uploading a short format and a long format? Long for people who are interested and short for people who just want the basic comment. Yes, Glitch, I actually have. I should really do that. The problem is doing, I guess I could just do a long format without any editing, but I don't feel the quality would be there unless I did some kind of editing on both, and it is very difficult for me to find the time in a week to do the videos I do as well as this live show already. So yeah, I've considered it, and we're gonna see. I'm hoping to go more with the live format instead of the, well, which will be the long format. We'll see. Let me know what you guys think in the chat. Zach said, I want to do starts doing some shorter videos, but I keep doing long ones. That was my problem for a long time, Zach. But I like the short format a lot better, and I can tell by the analytics that the short format is received better overall by the general YouTube community. With that said, it's not always possible for me to see whether it's this particular community of you guys out there that are liking it the best, because I have a lot, guys, I'll be honest, most of my video views come from unsubscribed viewers. Just recently, YouTube gave us the analytic capability of seeing subscribed versus unsubscribed, and I was blown away. Most of the views that I get on almost all of my videos come from Google search and YouTube search direct, and they are not subscribed. So when you see me ask for people to remind them to subscribe, don't get too sick of that because most of the views are not from subscribers, believe it or not. Eric Koss said, Eric, by the way, did you see that video on Google from Google on Project Solly? Well, I think I did, but I can't remember which one is that? The Solly project. Remind me what that one is. Paul is still here. Hey, Paul. And Zach said editing long video sucks. Yeah, it does suck. But I enjoy this. I do. I don't enjoy the editing process anymore as much as I used to, guys. But we'll see as I move into some new electronics content. Maybe I'll get back into it. I'm learning some new tips on editing lately and becoming less frustrated with it. So. Actually, the FPV videos gave me the window into learning that stuff. All right, guys, let's go. From the shop this week, guys, the video that went out this week, proximity flying, some RC FPV video. I spent a lot of time on the edit on this. Basically, it took me the entire week of this was condensing down. It was 23 gigabytes of raw footage down to, what did I get it down to? 4 minutes ish, guys. It's a lot of editing and just generally being ruthless and cutting everything out. I had everything from ground cameras, I had tons of footage. Some camera angles you didn't see in the video, they just didn't make the cut. I had cameras all over the place, everywhere, laying on the ground, sitting on the tables, on the planes. And I think it turned out good, guys. The video was well received. Thank you for your comments on it. If you didn't see it, check it out and let me know what you think of that format. I'd love to do a few more this summer, or a bunch more. Sneak peek of the upcoming, guys. I said this last week. I still have to do more on the H12C quadcopter video from GearBest. You will see a video on that upcoming. And then from there, what I have planned is a small list of items, basically core level electronics, some short format videos on some components such as the Arduino Mega, a solid state relay, a few other things that I've had on the list forever. And I just want to do some quick videos on how I'm using those in some circuits and going to use them in some projects upcoming. So, look forward to those, and I would really love to get into playing some more with the PCduino and the Raspberry Pi, but I'll be honest, I don't think I'm going to get to those probably until after the wedding and the busy time dies down in summer. So, we'll see. I just catch up on the chat real quick, guys. Ricky Chow said, I like the long because I think those videos are really good while you are working on something and you want something playing in the background that gives you useful information. I can't agree more, Ricky. That's when I like the long format a lot, is when I'm doing something else and I can sort of divert my attention but still follow along by listening. The long format is way better for that. The short format, where you condense an hour project into 3 minutes, is boom, boom, boom. You got to be watching to keep up. I couldn't agree more, Ricky. Zach asked, "What do you use for editing?" I'm using Lightworks Free Edition. Zach, I am using Adobe Premiere Elements 11 for the video editing, and I'll be honest, I've hated it since I purchased it. I use Adobe Lightroom for my DSLR, just. Yeah, up there, which is the most amazing program ever for initial still image editing. I love it. The thing is just simply amazing. Adobe Premiere Elements is not so amazing, and I find it frustrating. It's very difficult to do basic workflow items, but I am learning to get around that in ways, creative ways. Would I purchase it? No, but I'm stuck with it. Because I did purchase it, so I'd say maybe stay away from that one and try one of the other ones. Some of the other guys here, the other content providers, content producers can probably give you some more advice. Anna says, looking forward to more RC videos. Good stuff, because there will be more. Oh, Eric said, radar on a chip. Yes, Eric. Yeah, please do post that in the G+. Yes, I did see that. Actually, I think Harry or someone sent it to me by PM, but I didn't get it in time for the video. Yes, I did see that. Pretty cool stuff. Gesture recognition, kind of like the leap motion, but it's radar on a single chip. Really cool. Yeah, please do post that in the G+ community. Jim Connor said, I like long format videos, but they're more likely to get left unwatched on my subscriptions because I don't have the time. Yeah, I think we're all in that similar boat. It's when do you get the time for long format? It'd be nice, actually, if I could sort my watch later YouTube list, because guys, if you don't use it, you just click on the bottom of the videos and you can add them to your watch later. It'd be nice if I could sort that by video length. And then when I had the time for a long format, just go right to those. That'd be a pretty cool function. YouTube. Let's add that. Good stuff. Lots of good contacts. Good. Okay. Carry on, guys. Let's go. Oh, we're already 10 minutes over. Tech tip of the week, guys. This one will be really quick. Guys, you've seen one of these in tons of my videos. I use it all the time. But what I neglected to show you guys, because I keep ending up swapping the alligator leads and tearing these off, when you're using one of these third hand tools, so handy for soldering, working with components, super simple tip, take heat shrink tubing, put it on the end of the alligator lead, the clip, trim it off, and then heat shrink it right to the end. And then you don't mar wires, because these are really, really sharp. Clamp one on your finger, it hurts. You won't mar the light wiring and stuff like that. You won't punch through the insulation. A little bit of heat shrink over the tip of them. That's it, guys. That's my tip of the day. I use it a lot, and it's handy because sometimes when you're working with heavier stuff, I just strip it off. You just take your X-Acto knife, cut it, pull the heat shrink back off when you need the gripping power. And that's why mine's almost always bare in my videos, because I end up doing heavy duty or stuff all the time. That's my little tip for you guys. And let's go. What's next? Some comments this week, guys, real quick. Short version. Harry actually sent me to myself and Mr. Ziegerman. This is on the FPV flying video. I love the plane-to-plane camera shots. Which do you see when you fly FPV, the gorgeous 1080p that we see, or a lower res video that includes the OSD? And this is a good question for those that aren't flying FPV. The video I see is the low res version, and I don't necessarily have OSD on all of them. In the Freeman glider, the one that's in the predominant common in the videos, I don't have an on-screen display on that. But if you want to see what my downlink looks like, halfway through this proximity flying video, there's a on-screen display, looks like F-16 fighter style system. Well, it's a funny comparison, but that's what I see through the goggles, and it's quite low resolution. The camera res isn't too bad, but by the time it comes down to the camera, it can be it's not HD by any stretch, but definitely good enough to fly by. That's what we see. This is another question. I'm sharing this because I get it so often. I'm not sure whether this is the right audience, but I want to put it out there. Jason asks on my RFID with Arduino, does this mean if I borrowed one of my teacher's cards at school and quickly scanned it, but had the Arduino dump of the info on an SD using an SD shield, could I then clone it when I got home and have access to the off-limits parts of my school? Guys, I get this question on this video, I'd say 5 to 7 times a week. And most of them actually get flagged as spam for some reason. YouTube is picking up on the fact that I don't know how their algorithm is working. Guys, on any of my videos, long story short, if it can be used for nefarious purposes, you're not going to get a response from me. And I just simply don't respond to these comments. No, I will not advocate cloning RFID cards nor explain how to do it. The video has enough information that if somebody chose to learn how to do things, they could. But no, I will not help you to clone RFID cards. That is my rant on that. All right, guys. Zach said, I heat shrinked one of the tips of my alligator clips, but not the other. Absolutely, Zach, that's a great tip. If you only do one side, you can still have some of the bite, but be a little softer on things because you don't have both the interlocking alligator teeth. Absolutely, you can do just one side. It would definitely cut down the impact of it. It's a great tip, too. All right, guys, what else we got? This is about it. We are way over. We're into the next hour here, guys. So I'm going to close it down here shortly. Some closing thoughts, guys. So earlier we mentioned all the flooding and some just horrendous stuff going on in the southern U.S. And a story caught my eye. This is not the first time I've seen this story. I saw it actually before during Hurricane Sandy. Anheuser-Busch has ceased production of beer. Guys, don't be alarmed. It's only one factory. They ceased the production at one factory and switched over to producing canned water. I believe this was their Missouri factory. You can watch video down below. It's the Fox News coverage of it. And I thought this worthy of sharing because, in all honesty, I think this is better news than half of the crap on mainstream media and fear-mongering and all that other garbage. Regardless of what Anheuser-Busch, what their motives are, this is a socially responsible thing to do. And at the end of the day, in my opinion, this will make a difference in someone's life. I think they were doing, I forget how many thousands of cans of the 12 fluid ounces of water and shipping it. I think they're sending it via the Red Cross and FEMA to people who need it, because in a flooded area, potable water is virtually impossible to come by because everything is contaminated. This, regardless of what this motivation is, it's good to see big companies like this do a socially responsible thing. Odds are it's probably not going to cut into their bottom line too bad, but the fact that some do these things and some don't really makes me happy, and I love to see this and I love to share it with you guys regardless of how big of a difference it makes. It's the right thing to do. Big fan of it. Cheers. Next time I'll definitely have to buy some Anheuser-Busch brewed beer from the U.S. next time I'm there, because all of our stuff doesn't come from Missouri. But yeah, thought that was cool, guys. Thought that was worth sharing. That's it for the show this week, guys. Good luck in all your electronics ventures. Build something cool this week. Make a difference in someone's life. Do the socially responsible thing. Give something away. Share something. It's a really cool community we got going on here, guys. I love hanging out with you guys. This is the highlight of my week with you guys. So cheers. Good luck in all your electronics ventures, and best of luck this week. Cheers.